Hey everyone, it is Thursday. You know what that means? That means we bring back Jonathan Twomley. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing great, Michael. How are you?
I appreciate you, man. I really appreciate you being a little flexible. We're doing this one a little bit early today, but we got to start off with the unemployment claims. They came out. Another million people filed first-time unemployment claims. You know, not good. Trending the wrong direction. It's actually down, actually, from last week. Last week was 1.1, so it's a million, but still over seven figures. Continuing claims, though, is down 14.6, down 236,000, but still, we got a problem, don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and look, and listen, just as we talked about last week, it seems like we're sort of at a temporary bottom or plateau right now. Yeah. There's no, and it could go either way from here. And I think going into the fall, we're going to see more spikes in COVID, we would have wanted this to be lower. Like we would have been wanting to start off with a lower base, not still be over a million claims. And it is concerning. And if you've been following what's been going on with school openings and college openings, I mean, they've just had, you know, cases mushrooming as you'd expect from putting people together. And these college kids, as I think, you know, anybody could have guessed, no self-control, right? They think they're immortal and they're invincible, and they also all want to, you know, meet members of the opposite sex
or the same sex. Shocking.
And they are, right? So they all want to meet somebody, you know, to start a relationship or just for fun, and they're not going to be staying home in their apartments, you know. And so, you know, who could have predicted, right, that college students who brought them together would ignore all the rules. So that's, you know, that's going to be an issue and continuing to be an issue as more schools open up. You know, we get the southern schools tend to open up earlier, the northern schools open up later. So we're not even into September when, you know, schools across the north are going to open up. So I think we're just going to see more, and then it's going to be up to, you know, the local governments, how they react, and then what the effect on employment is going to be. But I don't think it's going to be good.
No,
I don't think it's going to be favorable.
Again, I like you. I would have liked to see this below a million and trending in the right direction. We needed a lower base because not only do we have the school issue, which certainly can lead to more unemployment. And also, again, college campuses, there are infrastructure, right? The College of Alabama, right? There's infrastructure around that. And if you move the kids to all remote, that infrastructure suffers, right? There are college towns, right, that are built around their sports. And if they're not there, man, to go a year without that's going to be tough. And then the other reality is we're about to get out of the summer. It's about to get cold, which is if you still can't eat inside, is going to hurt restaurants and, you know, where they hired some back, they're going to have to let them go. And then, of course, if we can't go inside because of mall closures, you know, the air conditioning and like, or heater, it's just not good. It's not good.
Yeah. I mean, and you know, I was actually yesterday had to take my wife into Midtown Manhattan to go to the Japanese consulate to pick up our daughter's new passport. And it's the first time I'd been in Midtown for a long, long time. I don't have, you know, because everything's based in Brooklyn and my home is in Brooklyn. My office is in Brooklyn. So I don't have to go into the city at all. And when we went in, the first thing to note was that, you know, there's been reports of this being like a urban hellhole, which is, I don't know where these reports are coming from. Cause it was, it was empty, right? It was empty. And, you know, there were a few people walking around. There's a ton of construction going on. Cause I think that the city and the state have been trying to keep the economy a little juiced with like accelerating construction projects. So everywhere you go, there's street construction. But the sidewalks were really empty. And, you know, what you realize is that all of those businesses in Midtown Manhattan are dependent on people being in Midtown at the offices, you know, having lunch, having dinner, having drinks, doing shopping on their lunch hour, like whatever it is, they're, because nobody lives around there, right? So it's all it's all dependent on office workers. And without that, I mean, it's devastating for the economy. So, you know, all these things have a knock-on effect, just like the college towns that need to have students there spending money. Places, you know, business districts need to have people there spending money. Mm-hmm. And there's a ripple effect throughout the economy, mm-hmm. for not just from the closures, but from, you know, all those office workers, if they're home working, getting paid, that's great for them personally. Mm-hmm. But what's happening is, and this kind of leads into our next topic, what are they doing with that money? Well, basically, right. they're putting it into the bank.
Right. Right.
They're not out there, you know, buying lunch out at restaurants, buying, you know, having drinks with their coworkers after work, because mm-hmm. they can't do these things. They're just, you know, either putting it in their pocket or, you know, like me, they're buying all kinds of crap on Amazon to keep their kids entertained.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, the amount of calico critters that we have accumulated since the beginning of the crisis, I mean, you wouldn't believe it. But
yeah, it's great.
But that's all, you know, that's where the money is going. It's not going into eating out and spending in local stores. So
yeah, so that's a great segue. One of the things we wanted to talk about today is the concept of velocity of money. Now, for a lot of the listeners or viewers, they may have heard velocity of money, but it really hasn't translated to the average Joe. You want to take a shot at sort of giving an example of what velocity of money is and why it's important?
Yeah. So the velocity of money is a measure of essentially like how often a dollar is trading hands, right? So circulating through the economy. So that in a normal circumstance, you know, that office worker is getting paid. They're going out at lunchtime. They're spending that dollar on a sandwich. That goes to the store owner who's giving some of that dollar to his employees, and he's taking some of the dollar for himself and some of it's going to rent, mm-hmm. right? And then it just goes through the economy that way. And mm-hmm. the faster these transactions happen, the more velocity you have. And the more velocity you have, basically, the more you have inflationary pressures and stuff mm-hmm. like that happening, mm-hmm. right? So, and then when velocity slows down because people aren't spending, then there's less economic activity and less inflation or deflation. So we're in a situation right now where there's been a lot of people are concerned about inflation because mm-hmm. there's been so much liquidity pumped into the market. But the problem is that the velocity of money is way down because the opportunity to spend is down. And also probably, you know, there has to be some hunkering down too, as you have in any recession where people start mm-hmm. feeling like, well, maybe I shouldn't spend because I don't know what's coming. So I need to have cash. Mm-hmm. And so the economy contracts when you have the velocity of money slowing down. And that's actually happening right now is reading on Seeking Alpha about the velocity of money being way off compared to last year, despite all of the money that's been pumped into the system. And so my personal view is that, you know, even though people are very concerned about inflation, I don't see it. And the reason I don't see it is this is sort of corroboration of my view, but the money that's being pumped into the system is replacing money that is replacing income that was lost, mm-hmm. right? It's not dumping money on top of a strong economy. Like arguably, for instance, say the tax reform bill that was passed in 2018, that was an inflationary measure because the economy was hot and suddenly it was saying, oh, here's some more money on top of a hot economy.
Yeah.
Right. And all that we saw that, you know, translate into asset inflation because mm-hmm. most of the tax cuts went to the top, you know, the top of the income scale. And that's those people invest rather than spend, right? Mm-hmm. Right. Proportionally.
Predominantly.
Yeah. But this money, all this money that's been pumped into the system is basically the Fed and Congress replacing money that was lost in the economy. So it doesn't have the same kind of inflationary effect. Mm-hmm. And on top of it, people don't have the opportunity to spend the money. Mm-hmm. So it's not contributing to inflation. Now, I know a lot of people are saying, well, it's when the economy comes back, it will translate into inflation then. But I'm dubious about that. Just for the same reason, because the people who have a propensity to spend, meaning the people at the lower end of the income scale, will have spent all the money
Right.
And the people at the upper end, you know, will just do what they always do with it, which is invest in more stuff. So,
yeah, yeah.
So I don't see this translating into inflation. And then if you just look at history from around the world, including this country, you know, people who are old enough to remember the great financial crisis, remember all of the inflation, and gold bugs who the inflation, warriors and gold bugs from in 2009 who said, yep, we can't do this big $1 trillion stimulus bill because it's going to lead to inflation. And all we've seen for the last 11 years is the Fed desperately trying to get inflation to 2%,
yep,
unsuccessfully with super low interest rates. And it just didn't, they haven't been able to. So also, if you look at Japan has been doing that for 30 years. Mm-hmm. Their bubble popped in 1989. They've been fighting deflation ever since. Mm-hmm. And they're only partly successful at it, basically in that they've avoided outright deflation most of the time, but they've had it a couple of times. Mm-hmm. So it's, I think that there are forces at work other than just the simple, low interest rates and money supply that are working against inflation. So I think the real danger is deflation, not inflation.
Yep.
And I'm not really concerned about inflation, to be honest, but yep, but I know a lot of people are. And so on top of all that, today we have Chairman Powell.
Let's get to that in a minute. We'll get, yes, to that one next.
Yes.
Yeah. There's a couple of things that you went through that I want to make sure people realize. So first off, the velocity of money concept. So on this channel, you have heard me talk about multiple times about the savings rate going up. That's just people stocking away cash. And as Jonathan talks about, that's from a couple of things. Both the opportunity or the propensity to spend is down, right? You're not at the job. You're not buying the sandwich in your example. You're not buying stuff on your lunch break or buying drinks after work. And again, people are saving more. And then there are certainly some fear or, stocking away cash because you're concerned about what's coming, which is probably the right thing to do in a recession, right? Then there's the whole argument of people now looking at that and saying that's dry powder that's coming. And I think you're right again. It's dry powder that's coming for assets, right? I think there's a group, what is it called? Tiger 21, I think it is. Basically, it's a bunch of, I think you have to be a deca millionaire to be in that group. I read an article from that team yesterday, or it might have been the day before. They all blend together, where they have been actively, they meaning the group, on average stacking cash the last 6 weeks.
Mm.
Meaning selling assets, whether that they didn't declare, but there's only a couple of things you can sell and transact in 6 weeks, stocks and bonds quick. Yeah. And you could probably do real estate in 6 weeks, but it's close. But why are they doing that? Well, I mean, these are deca millionaires, folks. They're stacking cash because they see, winter is coming, right? They're the grasshopper or the whatever, the ant. I don't remember which analogy. I guess they're the ant, not the grasshopper, because they're getting ready, right? They see stalemates in Congress. The Republicans are going to take another shot at doing a skinny stimulus deal today, supposedly about everything they agree on. Goosed unemployment's $400, PPP money, money for testing, and money for schools. We'll see what happens, but I don't think Nancy's going to go for it. I think she's going to say, I want my $900 million or $1 billion for the states, which is a non-starter for the Republicans. So I think everybody is starting to think that another stimulus bill is not going to happen until after the election, which means you probably should be like Tiger 21 and stacking cash. Again, velocity of money is going to go down.
And I actually would like to sort of key off this for a minute, which is one of the arguments that I've heard repeatedly about, well, certainly in the multifamily business, is that cap rates will not fall in multifamily because there's all this dry powder on the sidelines. And this is an argument that I have never really understood, because the dry powder is on the sidelines because they're waiting for bargains.
Exactly.
They believe a crash is coming. And they're stockpiling cash to buy distressed assets. Right now, you've seen some of this happening now already in hotels, where those were the first assets to become really distressed, and you've seen people starting to swoop in to buy some of that stuff.
Yes.
They're not looking for a 10% discount off peak pricing, right? So the idea that somehow this is going to keep the market high is just from a logical perspective, makes no sense at all. Like these are people who are extremely sophisticated,
yeah,
and they've been stockpiling cash for some time. This isn't like something that they just started doing last year.
Yeah.
They've been, this stockpile has been building for since at least 2015, 2016.
No, exactly.
When and it's very patient money, right? And
that is the key. It's patient money, right? They're not looking for the 10% off sale. Right. They're looking for the 10% off slash 20% off. And then the triple whammy extra special, you know, everything must go sale.
Yeah. This is the people who look to buy assets for pennies on the dollar, right? They're not looking to buy a 10% discount off peak pricing, meaning last year's all time historically high price.
Yeah.
Right. Before we had this year's all time historically high price. That's not where this money is waiting.
Not interested.
This money is waiting for being able to, you know, relieve a bank of a problem that it's willing to take a huge haircut on just to get this thing off its balance sheet. That's what this money is waiting for. And so last time around, you know, you saw multifamily prices going down by about 37%.
On average. There were other markets. Right. I bought stuff for 70% off.
This is a national average, right? So, and that's institutional grade multifamily. Right?
Yes,
that's
true.
Right. So, and multifamily was the best performer because everything else didn't even work.
That's true.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the level of discounts that I think this money has been trained to wait for.
Yeah. Right? And it's happy to wait. That's the key. It's patient. Yeah. I love that word. Patient money. Yeah.
So I think that, you know, the opportunity may never materialize, but that's not what that money is there for. It is patient opportunistic money. And if it doesn't get spent on multifamily, if the opportunities never, materialize. Yes, that's the word I was looking for. In multifamily, then they'll look for some opportunity somewhere else.
Oh, for sure.
Good. So it'll be buying, you know, corporate debt at a discount. It'll be buying companies outright at a discount. Whatever it is.
Yeah, that's a great point. This is not focused multifamily money, right? We talk multifamily. We are real estate folks. This is patient money, right? The Tiger 21, and I hope I'm saying that right. I forget if it's the Tiger, whatever.
I know, I've heard of the group. I think it is. I think you're right.
Yeah, 21, right? That's patient money looking for a deal. Looking for a steal, right? They want almost a no-lose situation.
Right.
That's the kind of discount they want. And if it's not in multifamily, they will go somewhere else. That's the power of that. And the other thing I want to say about the dry powder is a lot of people that are now in social media talking about multifamily and real estate, they didn't even experience the last crash.
Yeah.
They read about it, but they didn't experience it, right? Yeah. You and I I was in it. I saw the run up. I saw the run down. Yeah. I profited on both sides. So I know what it feels like. I know what a deal looks like in an 8 to 10% haircut. But the point I'm making here is this deca millionaires, this tiger money, that wasn't their first crash, right?
Yeah.
They experienced the .com crash and they profited from. They experienced the crash of the SNL crisis probably in the 80s. So again, this money is willing to wait. I love that patient money. They will absolutely deploy it wherever the deals are. And that might not be in multifamily.
And I love the fact that you said that this is money that's looking for a steal or no lose proposition. Yeah. When I first got into the business as an investor, which is right after the crash, I was out talking to family offices and they were saying essentially that to me. They were saying, we're not interested in your measly little 20 IRR deal.
Right.
It's not interesting to
us.
Not
meaningful, yeah.
Yeah. It's, you know, we're looking for, you know, massive return. We're looking for 50 IRRs, right? And that's what we're dealing with. So when people in the multifamily industry are saying, oh, all this dry powder is going to come off the sidelines, they're not looking for your 20 IRR deal. They're looking for 50, 60, 70 IRRs, right?
Mm-hmm. They're willing to put it anywhere. That's the key.
Yep. Yeah. And they have the money to do it and they have the patience to do it, right? Yeah. So,
and the experience.
And access to those kinds of deals as well, right?
So, yeah, people call them, right? They don't seek them, they call them, right? Family offices. This is some key stuff that people need to realize. This is not their first rodeo. You know, they're waiting for the no lose deal. and they don't have to deploy in a multifamily. We like to talk multifamily. It's our thing. It's what we do. But these family offices, they don't really care where it goes. They're not tied to an asset. That's pretty key. So let's switch gears because, again, velocity money is a new concept for folks. Jerome Powell, much talked about speech. I haven't read it yet. I plan to watch the rerun, if you will. He talked about a new concept today, which is important for people to understand, and it's called inflation averaging. Have you heard that this morning, Jonathan?
Well, I didn't really focus on the term. I just saw the synopsis of what he had said.
Okay.
What
did you take from it?
Well, what did I take? Essentially, I mean, it actually seems to me more inflation targeting, right? Which is what they've ostensibly been up to, but it was more of like a soothe the markets announcement where they're essentially forecasting, and this is what feeds into my earlier point, trying to actually create inflation by creating the expectation of inflation in the market and letting the market understand that we're going to tolerate inflation. Basically, what they're saying is they're signaling to the market that, hey, if we get some inflation, don't worry, we're not going to raise interest rates on you. Because we're going to tolerate inflation. But of course, tolerate inflation doesn't mean 20% inflation. It means, they'll let it go to 3%, right? And which we haven't seen in ages, right?
I can't remember the last time.
3%, it's been probably 20 years.
Yeah, 80s probably.
Yeah. So, but they're trying, and again, this goes to this velocity of money point, and it goes to this fear of inflation point. The Fed is trying to create inflation. And so if, they need to create inflation because they need to now inflate their way out of all this debt.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
And they need to get economic growth above interest rates so that they can basically inflate the debt away.
But
if you think about what's going on, now people are always saying, oh yeah, the Fed is going to have to inflate the debt away. And therefore, we're going to have lots of inflation, and therefore, I need to invest in real estate right now. What they're thinking in their heads is like, it's going to be 1979, we're going to have 20% inflation again. That's not what's going to happen here, right? No. Anyway, if that did happen, your multifamily assets would really, you think that's great for, it's terrible for you if that happens, right?
Yes,
it's absolutely terrible for you if we have inflation of that level, because you get locked into leases that a year from now are 20% less than they were than the day you signed them. Right.
Yep.
So, and you can't get debt and you can't refinance. Like this is bad. A little bit of inflation is great for multifamily.
True.
And that's where the Fed is trying to get us, and they're not sure they can. So they're trying, and they've been trying for the last 11 years to get us there, and they haven't been able to. So this is, to my mind, them again, trying to signal to the markets like, hey, we hear you. We know we need to inflate the economy. Believe me, if inflation goes to 5%, you're going to see big rate hikes, and that is not going to help real estate.
Anybody?
At all.
No.
Right. So
even residential, inflation goes to 5%, mortgage rates will be 9%. That'll crush the real single family. Will just dry up.
Yeah, and multifamily, try to refinance when that happens. Your DSCRs are going to be all messed up. Yep. You're going to have to put additional capital into your deals. Believe me, like inflation is not your friend.
Yeah. At that level.
At that level. So, but deflation is really the fear, I think.
Yeah. I think what I took from it, again, I haven't read it in detail. It was one of the first things I did read. It came out at 6:10 this morning, when his speech came out. But what I took from it is first off, there's nothing magical about 2%. I think there was a feeling in the market, because again, they've been saying it for years, if inflation hit 2%, rates go up, right? It's kind of what happened in 2018, right, when they got a little aggressive with rates. What they just did today is they took it off, so it's definitely more dovish. But what I'm reading in it, and I won't know until actually I read his press release or whatever your presentation is, what I took from it is they're going to try some new things, and they're not sure how effective or ineffective they're going to be. They see some risk that it could be a little bit more inflationary, and they're gonna be like, okay, don't worry, we're okay, we're gonna watch it. And if it goes to 2.7 or 3% even, don't think we're gonna raise rate. Because what this really is rates are gonna stay low longer. That's what I took from it net.
Yep.
Capital is going to be cheaper longer. That seem fair?
Yeah, and I don't know how we ever get out of this either. I mean,
yeah, true.
I don't know how we ever go back to what, you know, you and I grew up with as normal interest rates. As you
I
know,
agree, I really do agree. Yeah,
and you know, and I think, and all the debt, you know, the debt has it's. I mean, we got into ourselves into this vicious cycle where the debt, you know, creates a drag on economic activity, right? Because so much money just goes into interest payments, right?
Yep.
And then you know, you have then interest rates have to be maintained at a low level, because otherwise the federal government and frankly corporations too will just get eaten alive by debt service, right? So we're sort of in this trap of you know, ever lowering yields, which for, you know, for normal people makes it very difficult to save for retirement, right? Makes it very difficult to do a lot of things, right? So, and frankly, the debt, the more we pump debt into the system, and again, I think this leads into this velocity of money and deflation problem.
Yep.
The more money the more debt we pump into the system, the less effective the debt becomes, right? So when you're, when you're trading, when there's very little debt in the system, when the government's running like a very small deficit, you know, you add a dollar of debt and it can create like $4 or $5 of economic activity.
Exactly.
Right now we're in the opposite situation where it's taking about $4 of debt to generate $1 of economic activity, and it's only going to get worse from here.
Yeah.
So if we don't clean this mess up, we're going to have to bite the bullet at some time and clean this mess up. And I don't really see how we do that without, you know, some combination of tax increases and spending cuts and, you know, sucking some of the liquidity out of the system. And that's going to be deflationary. But, you know, when, what I don't understand, I guess, sort of like in a larger perspective is when did deflation become such a bad thing? Right. Mm. You know, like, you need to have deflation periodically to kind of weed out.
Cleanse the system.
Cleanse the system, yeah. You don't have any kind of creative destruction without it.
Yeah, and that's the word I've been searching for. That's what we've been missing here in the last 20 or 30 years of my investing career is creative destruction.
Yeah, there's been a lot of creation, but then there's been a lot of like
zombies,
popping up of zombie companies. And you know, Michael, you're probably old enough to remember this, but a lot of people listening are not. You know, if you read books about the Japanese economy that were written in the 90s by Americans, there was a lot of criticism of, hey, you Japan, you don't know what you're doing because you're propping up all these zombie companies. You just have to let them die. You just have to let them die, reallocate the capital where it's better used. But, and here we are, you know, 20 years later.
Yeah,
exactly the same thing.
We are
right? Not like that, but we're like encouraging it with, you know, corporate tax cuts and other things, just letting these companies pump up their own stock, giving them access to cheap capital to keep going when they really should just go out of business and, you know.
Well, that was going to be my question for you, because I know you have a special connection to Japan, right? Far more history than I do. Is there anything structurally in the U.S. where we won't, or we can't, I guess can't is the right word, be Japan in 30 years, where we just fight this for 30 years? I mean, could we?
Wait, you mean how we can avoid that fate?
No, I'm wondering why, is there anything in our economy or maybe constitutional law or something that says we can't let this go on for the next 30 years? Basically, can we have rates this low for 30 years, I guess is what I'm asking.
I used to think, right, back in the 90s, that like, you know, boy, Americans are just a lot better at kind of like taking the bad news and just dealing with
it. Take it on the chin.
Yeah. Take it on the chin, just deal with it, like let it happen and fight our way out of it. And what I've seen over the last 20 years is that just isn't true. And on top of it, I think that our political system is more dysfunctional than Japan's is. Because they have a parliamentary system where you have one party in charge, or at least you have a coalition government, and they just, you know, have a policy and they institute it, and then if it doesn't work, they they lose and they someone else gets to try.
Yep.
Whereas in our system of divided government that's become extremely partisan,
good point.
It becomes very difficult to try anything. And certainly there's no political will to say, like, raise taxes if that's necessary, right? And you can, it's just like a one-way ratchet. You know, in Japan, it's actually quite easy to raise taxes. And that might be another problem where it's like they have a ratchet in the other direction. But you don't see these debates of like, these like no tax pledges and stuff where, you know, basically they, you know, politicians remove from themselves the responsibility of ever dealing with the situation they've created, right? Mm-hmm. So they're, you know, in Japan, you see this discussed all the time. And obviously everyone hates tax increases, but it's not like, it's just a different kind of debate, right? Yeah. It's not like, you know, you're evil incarnate if you discuss raising taxes, because sometimes that needs to happen. There should always be like times where you're raising taxes, times where you're cutting taxes, you're trying to balance the system, right? You're not, there's no, like, we have this sort of fundamentalism here that says like the only good thing to do is ever cut taxes and somehow that's going to save us. And we've been doing that for a long time. And look where we are. We wound up with enormous budget deficits, you know, super low interest rates to finance the budget deficit and just fiscal irresponsibility all the way around.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, and people act as if like a tax cut is somehow not fiscally irresponsible. It's absolutely fiscally irresponsible if you continue to spend all the money. Exactly. Right. So, and in this country, we wouldn't do this. I mean, actually, if you read about Lyndon Johnson, when Lyndon Johnson became president, he wanted to stimulate the economy with a tax cut. So he went to the Senate and was talking to some of the leaders of the Senate, who at the time were Democrats. And they said, there were Southern Democrats who are now, you know, all Southern Republicans, but basically the same people. And they said, they were like, well, no way, no how without some, we will not cut taxes unless you also cut the deficit. I'm sorry, cut the budget. So they worked out a deal with a small tax cut and a small budget cut. And that was, you know, because the idea then was fiscal rectitude, right? Mm. Then we wound up in the 1980s with, oh, we got this Laffer curve thing, which has never worked in practice. The more we cut taxes, the more money we'll have. It doesn't make sense on its face, but supposedly the idea was like you juice economic growth so much that it pays for itself, and it never has.
Yeah.
So, but that became a way for politicians to promise people free stuff. Like, hey.
Yeah, it was their story. Oh, that's good for me. I can tell that story, the Laffer curve.
Yeah. Yeah. So here's some free stuff. We're going to cut your taxes, but we're not going to cut your benefits at all.
Yeah.
And we're going to give you all this free stuff. And so, that's where we are today. So I would like to see us return to some kind of, you know, fiscal rectitude, but I just don't see it happening.
Yeah. Well, good news is we have an election coming up. We'll see what happens at the end of it. But I think today's conversation was awesome. Velocity of money, understand it. Why there is an inflation, Powell going after inflation averaging. Talk about Japan, deflation, you know, creative destruction. This has been a lot of fun, Jonathan. I appreciate you.
Absolutely. Well, I always enjoy myself in these, you know, these calls because I get to just talk about this stuff. I don't get to talk about this with anybody else. So it's great to talk about it with you.
Awesome, Jonathan. Thank you, buddy. Have a wonderful day.
You too. Thanks.
Thanks.